Hello and welcome to the weekly iteration. Today we are going to be talking about one of my favorite topics, which is how to get faster in Vim. Joe and I are here to drop some knowledge bombs on you. Take shelter. So the first thing worth knowing is that if you are not a Vim user, if you are a beginner, you don't need to be scared. Vim has this really intense mythology around it where people think that learning it is incredibly hard.
Which, to be fair, certain Vim users help to propagate.
True. There's a little bit of an elitist attitude there, yeah. Probably, which is like, well, you're not quite ready for Vim. The truth is it's not that hard. It's not that scary. There's a tool. To get started, this is how I recommend you start. Go to your terminal, type Vim Tutor. It's a 15-minute thing that walks you through the most basic Vim commands and gets you going. And honestly, after 15, 20 minutes of that, you are ready to start editing text. Like, you can actually start getting stuff done. Within a couple days, you're going to be basically productive. In a few weeks, I think you'll pass your old editor speed. It's just not that bad. So don't be afraid. That's the most important thing to keep in mind.
Right. And Vim Tutor is like totally accessible and approachable. It's interactive, so it's not like, oh, I'll read a book on it, and mm-hmm. I'll be super bored while I read it, and then, you know, then maybe I can use Vim.
Right.
Like Vi Tutor, it really is like a 15-minute thing, and it actually has you do the stuff you're learning how to do.
Yep.
And I agree that, like, it's so easy to get better than your editor with Vim because most editors just don't do anything. People mm-hmm. spend so much time making them look pretty and like maybe have better syntax, but the actual editing part of it is just like you have arrow keys and you can insert stuff. Maybe you have copy paste, maybe mm-hmm. some snippets.
Right.
But
like, it gets a little more advanced than that, but like I haven't seen anything that comes close. Like Sublime, no. TextMate, no. Like you just are not getting there. Vim or Emacs are pretty much, you need to get to that level to have like serious efficiency from an editor.
Right. So once you figure out the basic insert mode, like your old editor is already, you know, eclipsed.
So. Yep. So don't be scared. Get started. Try it out. I'll help you if you get stuck. Let me know. Beyond that, let's say you're an intermediate. You've done some of this stuff. You're getting reasonably proficient with Vim. How do you get up towards the advanced side and keep chipping away at that that task, getting faster? Here are a handful of advices.
Nuggets.
Recommendations. Number one, stay out of insert mode. There's a mode called normal mode. It's called normal mode because you should normally be in normal mode. Normal mode is where what you type doesn't happen on the screen. It moves the cursor around. Stay in normal mode. Like, you should think of insert mode as like a place you go for as minimal time as possible. It's like a lousy vacation spot. You want to get in, do what you have to do, and then get out. Get back to normal mode as quickly as you can.
Right. There are a few settings in Vim you can enable that make insert mode unbearable. So you can make it so that you're not allowed to backspace over where you started. So like a lot of people when they're new to Vim think like, oh, I want to delete all these characters. I will go into insert mode after them and hold backspace.
Mm.
Like, it's really tempting to do that kind of things when you're used to a normal editor. Or like, oh, I'm in insert mode and I want to insert something somewhere else. I will use the arrow keys.
Right.
So you can disable those.
Yep.
Basically, taking away all of the things you use from insert mode besides just typing stuff, at least for a while, will make you way more efficient.
Yeah, and we have a couple other ideas of things to take away that will help you go in the right direction. First of which is the arrow keys.
Mm-hmm.
It's very tempting in the beginning to not want to learn the HJKL movements and to instead move your hand over to those arrow keys. Don't do that. It's very easy to disable those arrow keys and bind them to no ops instead, and I recommend you totally do that so that you learn the HJKL movements. And why? Because it keeps you in the home row. It keeps your fingers right where they should be in the right spot on the keyboard and not all the way over here, not wasting this time like traversing this distance trying to get over to the arrow keys.
Right. And all that sounds trivial, like if you want to move around, like, oh, I only need to move my hand like 5 inches. Why do I care?
Mm-hmm.
Once you get to the point where you use those keys for all of your different motion combinations, like deleting text, indenting text, combination with different numbers, it's so much faster to be able to just hit a button than it is to move and hit a button. Like, you will use those for everything.
Yep. Worth learning. And the crazy thing is, once you get off the arrow keys and start using HJKL, you know what you should do next is stop using HJKL.
Right.
HJKL are fine-grained motions. They move you, you know, up one line or character, left and right. And what you actually want to be doing is moving a little bit more efficiently than that. So the next thing I would say is make sure you learn really well the different movement characters. Like word, or W for word, moves you forward by words. So much better than moving by, you know, just holding L. I would consider basically any time you hold down a character to be a smell.
So or like, press it more than once.
Or press it more than once, exactly. So like if I'm moving over, I want to move by at least words by typing W, or back with B. E moves me through the ends of words every time. GE moves me backwards to the ends of words. You can see that Vim considers a lot of those punctuation words, which is good and bad. But I will you'll basically never see me do this. Hold and scroll, hold and scroll. Oh, I need to get over here. Let me just do this. Huge anti-pattern. Like, don't do that. Instead, use the word things. You can also use F and T, I think, are like two of my favorite motions. Mm-hmm. So if I know I want to change something over on that hash, I can say F for find and then curly brace, and it will jump me to that. Mm-hmm. So F will take me all the way over there. If I wanted to change something up until that hash, I could say use the T motion. T will move me all the way except one space away. So I could say C, T, open, curly. Mm-hmm. You can see it doesn't include that. If I'd done C, F, open, curly, it includes it.
Right.
Really worth knowing.
And one of the really big advantages of that, like, a lot of people think that this is just like really low level optimization and it's obnoxious. You're just trying to squeeze a few milliseconds. Like, instead of holding down L or like scrolling over, you jump over. Like, so what? Mm-hmm. But one of the great things about the modal editing in Vim is that anything you can do is a single thing, like go to this character or change until this character, you can also repeat and reuse. Mm. And so if you have a few lines that you want to, you know, delete up until the curly brace, you could hold down delete three times. But you could also just do the first one, delete until the curly brace, go down and say, do that again.
Right.
And like, that starts to have massive consequences at scale. Like, maybe holding over to get to one line isn't such a big deal, but it becomes a point where, like, okay, if you frequently do that in a few lines at once and you do that all day because it's your job, like, you start saving like an hour a day just doing stupid typing.
Yeah, I can actually show you an example of that real quick. So like, let's say we want to remove, like, we've stopped using name here before these splits. Like, we've moved these methods into a name class, for example, and we want to remove name dot on both of these. Mm-hmm. I can do df dot for delete, find, period, and then just move down to here and do it, hit dot and do it again. Repeat mm-hmm. that same thing. Because I've referred to like what I want to do in a sort of abstract way, I can repeat it in different places with that dot command. Whereas if I had done XXXXX, delete this thing, and then I can't just hit dot, I've worked it too fine-grained a level.
Right. And so not only did you make it faster, but then you made it so the second time it cost basically nothing.
Yep, absolutely. Another thing along those lines is relative number, which I'm a huge fan of. So you'll notice as I move my cursor around, my cursor is always on line 0. And that 0 moves around with my cursor. And the reason I like this is because it makes it easier to refer to distances or sort of ranges of lines. So if I wanted to get rid of both these methods, I could, of course, hold DD, hit DD a bunch of times. But again, repeated things are a smell. So what I would do instead is say, OK, I'm on line 0. 7 lines away is the bottom of the other method. So 7 DD, and they're gone.
Right, or D7J.
Sure, exactly. D7, delete 7 down, which actually gives me one extra line.
Right, and that's where HJKL get really powerful. Mm-hmm. Like, pressing them repeatedly, inefficient. But combining them with other motions actually makes them really powerful. Especially with something like relative number, you can see how many lines you want. You can say, like, indent 10 lines down, or copy 10 lines down, or delete 10 lines down, or anything.
Yep, absolutely. Yeah, I use it a lot now. I really like a relative number. Very recommended. Also, it's useful for things like if I wanted to copy a method from above to below, like, for instance, I want to move first name to where I am, I can say minus 16 to minus 14, copy to here. And then I get that method copied down. Now, in a big file, you can still do that with absolute line numbers, but in a big file, that might be line 152 to line 158. And it's just more typing. You're never more than like 16 or 20 characters lines away.
Right. And we try to keep our files small, but even so, like, relative number, you'll almost always be working with single digits. And even in a small file, you're almost always working with double digits. So it's generally a gain even if you keep like 20 line files.
Mm-hmm. Totally. I just want to cover a couple like more like long distance moving commands, because I think these are really useful to know and are better alternatives to holding J and K. One is a high, middle, low, I think of it. Capital H, capital M, capital L. High, medium, low. High, middle, low. Really handy. I like that for like getting roughly where you want to go. Because I realize that most of my time in Vim is like editing existing things that are there. And so a huge portion of the time is get your cursor to where it's supposed to be, then perform a small edit. And so when you can do a big jump, like say I want to change like the method that we call an OAuth access token down at the bottom, if I can get down to there in one line, now I'm pretty close, and I can say FF to get to for user, change to open paren, and I've just gotten there and not a lot of keystrokes, which is nice. So high, middle, low are nice. Another way I might do that is by searching like that. that worked out nicely in this case because there was only one instance of that. It's less effective when you have a less unique token.
Mm-hmm. You sort of develop an instinct for that over time. Like you learn to scan forward and search.
Yep.
To figure out whether you should use F, T, go down, N, whatever.
Yep. But I think the most important part is actually just the mindset of moving in an efficient way.
Right, like seek and destroy.
Right, exactly. Don't scan and destroy type thing. So there's a great plugin that I can recommend that will help encourage you use these better motions called hard mode. It disables the arrow keys, HJKL, page up, page down, and things that encourage you to rely on character-wise navigation. And I think this is actually a really good idea after you've gotten past that beginner phase, like what's going on? You sort of have a rough idea of what's happening, but you want to be more efficient. This is worth trying out.
Mm-hmm. Another thing I recommend to people when they're first starting, and this is very annoying eventually, mm-hmm. but you can just go into your keyboard settings and disable key repeat. Not only can you make it slow, you can just turn it off.
Mm-hmm.
And so if you find yourself like holding down or holding K, you can just disable that. So you hold K, and it just goes down one line. Mm-hmm. And you're like, oh, I better figure something out.
Yep.
And if you just enable that for like a week, by the end of the week, suddenly you know all of the good navigation commands.
Yep, I think that's worth doing too. So that's some good sort of high-level advice and some specific commands. I do want to recommend a couple plugins before we go, because I think there are a couple plugins that are really worth having and can really improve your Vim quality of life.
Mm-hmm.
One is some type of fuzzy finder. There are a couple that I like. I use Command-T, you use Control-P. Mm-hmm. People have different preferences, but the basic idea is something that lets you type roughly most of a file name and get what you want. So rather than having to type out app models user, I can start typing user. I just type US, and then I'm on the right file. It just shortens how many things you have to type to get where you want.
Right. And most graphical editors have something like this now.
Mm-hmm.
And so people are probably used to this style of editing. Unlike most graphical editors, I think, though, there are a lot of navigation commands built into a lot of these fuzzy finders.
Mm-hmm.
So in Control-P, for example, you can open a file, but also do it in a new tab,
mm-hmm.
or open it and do it in a vertical split,
yep.
and so on. And they're also, like, they have very powerful fuzzy finding. So you could say, like, I only want to find directories, or I only want to find things that aren't in my gitignore. And lots of neat little options like that that take your fuzzy finding to the next level and make it clearer.
Yes, exactly. So that's definitely some sort of fuzzy finder worth having for sure. I consider that basically like an essential to Vim. Similarly, Rails Vim, if you're working in Rails apps, Rails.vim is a plugin by Tim Pope. Lets you do handy things like move to, I'm in a model, and I can type colon R, and it knows it'll take me right to the schema entry for that model. I could have it, if you do colon A, it will take you to the test. You can do certain splitting, like split vertically and go to the model. And just sort of gives you these intelligent, like pairwise movements between different types of Rails files,
mm-hmm.
Worth having for sure. And then finally, in my essential plugins list is surround.vim. This is another one that feels like it should be built in. We have these curlies surrounding this line. If I wanted to change them, I could of course manually go between the two, or I could just say change surrounding curly braces to parens.
A really neat thing about that is that it takes a little while to get intuitive. But it makes a difference between left and right. So one of them means include a space around it, and the other one means don't.
Yep.
So you can, for example, say like, oh, I have parentheses with space, but I don't want the space.
Mm-hmm.
And actually delete the extra space. Or you have like tight parentheses, and you want to change them to curly braces with a space. It can do that.
Yep, exactly. Useful for things like this, like now our style guide says we're using double quoted strings instead of single quoted. Change surrounding single quotes to double quotes. It's very easy,
mm-hmm.
And also works does some very intelligent stuff with HTML tags.
Right,
and it's kind of the only way I like to work with HTML. Every time I do it without surround Vim, it's miserable.
Right, it can also add quotes around something, which is cool. So if you have like two words, you can say like add quotes around these two words,
mm-hmm.
which is pretty powerful.
Yep, YS two words with quotes. It takes motions, which is pretty awesome. So you can say surround up until the comma at the end of this line with a paren, things like that.
Right.
Super useful, one of my favorite things. So that's it. Those are some high-level advice, some specific motions, and a couple plugins to check out. Hope that was useful. I'd love to hear your Vim tips or your experiences learning the editor on the forum, and we'll talk to you soon.